my god. Wow. This thing is
disgusting.
Ugh. Looks like it was in a construction zone and an apocalypse, and then it got snowed on. Oh my god, it's a good thing we haven't turned it on, because there's just like metal server rack hardware just sitting on the motherboard here. Look. Well, I think it might short out, boys. Why are we even using this thing?
Well, we're not right now, that's for sure.
Oh! Oh, I can't even lift it all up.
Oh, I don't even want to touch this. I got a mask on, I'm still coughing.
You gotta be wondering why we would use a server like this when we have a shiny new backup server like this one right over here. This guy holds the backup for our main storage server, Whonnock, which has all the data for all of our ongoing projects for all of our channels. So thanks to this, if we somehow lost a piece or even all of that data on the main server, say to drive failures or even a fire in our server room, we'd have a local copy of it ready to go for our editors. But what if the worst case scenario happened? Say there's an earthquake or a tsunami and our whole building is destroyed. That is where our remote backup, sorry, our remote backup over 300 kilometers away comes into play. Except for one small problem. For the past 2 years, it hasn't actually been working. And unfortunately, we've used up all of our favors from server manufacturers, so we're gonna try to use this thing to replace it. We have no idea if it still works, so good luck, everybody. Good luck learning about our sponsor, KiwiCo. KiwiCo ships out crates that contain hands-on projects for kids to help develop their creative confidence and problem-solving skills. Learn more at the end of the video or at the link below. First order of business is let's get Annie Dale's server out of here so that it doesn't get corrupted.
Corrupted by the dust.
That's the thing, you dust one server next to another server, now you got two dusty servers.
Do you want me to take that? My god!
Do you want me to take that end? Well, I'm just asking. I'm just saying. I play a lot of badminton, you know? I lift a lot of 80-gram weights over and over and over again.
This side's way nicer.
Yeah, you're good. Don't worry.
Sorry, I just gotta scratch my back a little bit here.
No, we're sort of in a hurry.
Oh, yeah?
So let's just clean a server now then, I guess. Oh.
There is wood in here.
Yeah, it might be sawdust of some sort. Okay, we're gonna need to take this outside for the main event.
I agree.
Cleaning, but... What is some of this stuff in here? Like, what is that? What is that?
Some template for something. It's like plastic, too.
It's so dusty. Those of you who have been around long enough might actually recognize this as the very first Storinator that we ever rolled out. Got that silkscreen logo on the front from 45 Drive. So those are like ancient SATA Enterprise drives.
These ones are different. I put these, this was my test server like two years ago for like 2 months.
Well, you took really good care of it.
And Jake. Construction started, and it's just been like actually like 2 years.
Oh, you know what?
That's probably why this thing's in here. Yeah, a Vertex 2.
Oh my God. So I've had this Vertex 2 since I worked at NCIX. I don't know why we circled this at some point. It's a 60 gigger.
Oh, the motherboard. I didn't even look in this thing properly. Holy.
Yeah, that's gonna be a problem.
Like those slots and like the PCIe slots and the RAM slots, are those even gonna work anymore?
I hope so. So this is a triple redundant power supply.
It's huge. It's literally.
Yeah, it's enormous and it uses up like, I don't even think we can put a different power supply in here. That's another thing too, is we wouldn't normally try to roll a server with such outdated hardware because of concerns about power consumption. This is not efficient. This is like, pretty sure this is DDR3.
I think it's DDR4.
I don't think so.
No, 1.5?
It is. Hoo-wee! Either way, we're not that concerned about power efficiency because we don't pay for power in our rack space at that data center, so. Hey!
Thanks, ITEL.
Yeah, thanks, ITEL. Hey, the vertical parts aren't that bad. That's how you can tell that it was falling dust.
Just a little bit of drywall, you know?
For those of you wondering what the heck went wrong here, part of it is that this thing's been sitting around for a couple of years. But the other part of it is that it was accidentally left in a rack that was inside a construction zone. Now the construction workers very thoughtfully put like, they actually built a box around the rack thinking that they were protecting the delicate equipment inside. I guess they didn't understand that like, having a big opening in the top of it meant that the dust would go in the thing.
Anyways, whatever, we can fix it, hopefully.
Yeah. The fact that we haven't powered it on with this dust is good though.
Yeah.
If we powered it on, there's almost definitely something conductive in some of this dust. So this thing has 64 gigs of RAM. That's fine for an offsite backup.
I was thinking about adding more RAM, but I really don't think we need it, especially if we're gonna run Unraid. I think maybe we should vacuum it a little bit first.
No, we can't vacuum it because there's static problems with vacuuming. We can't suck, we have to blow.
Okay.
Okay.
I think this thing's gonna be enough for reference here. Let's just, it'll be fine.
All right, here we go.
Alex is like, what is going on?
It's like new, baby.
Oh, wow.
Right?
Way more convenient than getting an air compressor.
Yeah, I mean, I've had things like this before.
Usually the battery powered ones suck, but this one complains about vacuum being too staticky, sticks Swiffer in.
Look, we don't have to put this in the video.
We are putting this in the video, 100%. Oh, come on. Are you kidding me?
Well, I want it to be clean, don't I?
You at least have your Livestrong bracelet on? It's like, wait. How are you taking this off with a Phillips? The mounting hardware for this CPU cooler was lost, and so I like ghetto found some like that are the right size and put some washers on there. It works. That cooler, what is the acid tag? 0264. We're up to like 10,000 now.
Oh, wow.
Wow, this is old.
Here's a little spring-loaded mounting screw. It's just sitting here like this.
What is that even from?
This is not from this computer. How is this in here? Thanks, I hate it. I just need some paper towel. Who keeps moving the bloody paper towel from the PC build corner? I don't like Kim wipes. They don't have the absorbency of
Yo, you want some IPA, bro? Brandon brings the paper towel back.
Oh, well. Wait, so you found paper towel, but then you didn't actually-
like, you walked in like 10 seconds after we found paper towel.
Do you have to make noise while we're shooting?
I just wanna, there we go.
You know, you're doing four different things. You're watching TV, you're playing a game, you're texting on your phone, you're freaking get it to land on its
thing.
Oh wow,
that was pretty good. Wait, is this isopropyl?
Hold on, should I, no, it's not.
Here, catch.
What is this thing? What is this?
Do you need some tweezers?
Oh, it's just like a little bit of wire. This isn't even like a kind of wire we should be cutting in this office. Like it's not, network or anything.
Ethernet, is it not?
No, look at the color, it's weird.
No, this totally is Ethernet.
But also, why is it in there? Like in the socket? You should blow that off. Wait, before you, because this is dirty, you should blow it off first.
Now here's a...
Oh yeah, that'll do.
Clean the CPU before you put it in.
Why do we have like 200 sub to LTT wood chips?
Sub to LTT!
Because they're for a sponsor code.
Huh. How much work did you put into this?
Like an hour.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah! Can I help you at all?
Yeah, sure. Why don't you install some drives? That'd be helpful. I mean, we don't even know if this thing posts. That might be good to know before I even bother with this, actually. I'm just gonna keep installing SAS cards while you do your thing, okay? Here I am installing not one, but two SAS cards while you're just like slacking over there. Look at this, I'm even gonna have all the screws in before you get the cables in.
I'm already done.
Oh, you gotta put more than one power cable in this
one. Can't you tell it to shut up?
No, you can't.
I can.
What?
I am God. All redundant power supplies have a mute button.
Oh, well, that's pretty good.
Yeah. Can you imagine in a data center if, like, you had a hardware failure and it just won't shut up until you fix it?
Well, I thought that was the point of a hardware failure, like, being noisy.
Yeah.
Oh, wasn't done.
Whatever, Linda.
I thought you said it's past the thing. It's totally working.
Why
would you not tell me?
We had that, remember Albion that died?
Okay, that's
just
fair.
Give it a sec. I think it's fine.
That was a good post.
Yeah, it's good.
So we're using Iron Wolf Pro 12 terabytes.
Not all of them. Well, hey, and then these drives are from Annie-Dale.
Are you gonna let me talk or not?
Did you know these drives are from Annie-Dale?
So with the normal RAID, you got the stripey stripes across the multiple drives, okay? With Unraid, it actually puts the entire file on a single drive. So you're limited to single drive write speed. That's the biggest problem with it. For us though, it's not a problem because this is gonna be offsite with only a gigabit connection. For our purposes, this is gonna be more than fine. It's day two and I've got an update for you guys. We actually took out the Iron Wolf Pros because we realized another temporary server, Clover server, was full of Exos drives. So now we've got 22 of them, which is all we need for our offsite backup of Whonnock, plus snapshots of older versions of it so that in case something accidentally gets deleted, we can go back and get it real quick styles. We also went and updated the firmware on our HBAs, updated the BIOS on the board, updated the IPMI firmware, and this thing is humming so well, like I'd say it's a pretty good hummer, you know? Because it doesn't have the greatest power consumption characteristics and it's heavy.
Is it like an H1 or an H2?
It's a Hummer. Oh yeah, we also added a couple of 500 gig cache drives. These are running in RAID 1 and they're not super high performance. They're just MX500 SATA drives from Crucial, but they're high enough performance that if we wanted to run a VM or something like that, then we could. And realistically, they're way faster than we need since it's a 1 gigabit connection to this bad boy. Now all we gotta do is put the, where'd they go? Where the heck they, oh yes. Ah yes, the old 45 drives mechanism for covering up the drives.
Did they update that?
Oh, it's so much better.
I don't actually mind this one.
It's fine. These rods are really stupid. You're like, ow, damn it, my finger.
Oh. This thing is so cute. It actually like looks pretty new.
I know, it doesn't even look that old and decrepit anymore. So you know where this was originally deployed?
No.
In the hallway at the Langley house.
Really?
Yeah, like you would like trip over it in the top of the stairs there. Now I can show you what that looks like in the Unraid software. We're doing a parity sync right now, so you can actually see pretty much all of our drives are reading at their maximum speed of about 200 megabytes a second. The reason it's doing that is because we did change out those drives earlier today, and so we need to rebuild the parity data. Unraid does still have parity protection. It's just written individually to two dedicated drives. So we can lose up to two of the 22 drives that are in here without losing any data whatsoever.
Look at that capacity.
I was gonna say, another nice thing about Unraid is it's got a nice, easy to understand graphical interface. So you can see here, we've got 240 terabytes of offsite storage. This is kind of funny. It's an older system, but kind of still checks out. It's doing 3.9 gigabytes per second internally, just reading all the data off those drives and rebuilding.
Those poor HBAs are just ripping.
They're going, boys. Do you think if I wiggle wobble this thing around a bunch, that like read speed will go down?
It seems like a bad idea.
It's all fine and good to have a bunch of storage, but we're not gonna be like copying things manually. So what are we doing?
Backups are only good if it does it itself, right? You don't wanna rely on human error there, especially us two. Unlike Whonnock server, which does a live file backup to Annydale, which we built a few days ago. I guess you guys haven't really heard about that one yet. Anyways, Sensible Jellyfish Fryer, we're calling it Annydale now. It's great, yeah. Because this thing is running Unraid and we don't really expect the performance to be great, running a live file sync to it probably isn't the best idea, even with cache drives. So instead, we're gonna be doing snapshots. And now, because our backup server is running ZFS, we could do ZFS snapshots, but we actually are gonna use a tool called rsnapshot, which is based on rsync, a file transfer software that's very ubiquitous amongst the Linux community. The fantastic thing about rsnapshot, as the name implies, is it takes these snapshots, but they're also deduplicated. So say we have our 30 terabytes of like base footage on Whonnock,
sure,
and we add a terabyte a day.
Yeah.
Once it does that big backup, and say we're doing hourly backups and we wanna keep 24 of them, so we have a whole day's worth of them. Rather than just like making a new copy each time, it creates a new hard link, which is basically like a map that's pointing to those existing files that are already there. So that way, when we do our new hourly backup, it's only gonna add the, say, 500 gigs from whatever ingest we just did, and then it'll just point to the existing files.
Now the question becomes, what about deleted files? Well, that's fine too, because what it'll do is it'll take your new snapshot and it'll say, oh, hey, that's not there anymore. So we're just going to throw that out, but we're gonna leave it in your previous snapshot just in case you need it later. And then what'll happen is you set a policy within the software and say, okay, I wanna keep these snapshots for, let's say hourly for a week. And then I want to keep
that's
them.
That's a lot. Oof.
Is that okay?
I was thinking hourly for 24 hours.
Sure.
And then it takes, once that 24 hours is up, it recycles the oldest one as the daily backup.
So that's one of the reasons that this needs so much more storage than the Whonnock server that it is backing up, because it's actually going to be backing up everything that was on Whonnock server over the last probably month or two.
But when you think about it, say if we do one or two videos a day, realistically, we're not gonna pass like a terabyte a day of new footage. Like,
I don't know, David, can we?
Yeah.
Maybe a little bit more. Okay, whatever, it doesn't matter. We'll say it's a terabyte a day. 30 days of that, that's 30 terabytes plus the like 30-ish terabytes of like Whonnock we usually have. Should be well within the 240 we have, so.
You give those guys 100 terabytes, they fill it.
He's been doing pretty good so far.
The good news is that Unraid allows easy expansion of your Unraid array. So if we just ship a master carton of hard drives.
Here's some more iron rods.
We could take our sophisticated rods off here and it'll be fine.
Now, to show you guys what this looks like in practice, we've set up a test directory with a sort of 50 gig-ish project, and we've started the R snapshot hourly backup. And if we look in our backup thing here, we got this PDFs tech quickie, and look at that. It's getting transferred.
Yeah.
It's pretty slow because it's gigabit, but it is at least going. I think TurboWrite is on right now, so it's like got all the drives spun up, but we wouldn't leave that on in practice.
So there it is, in spite of what it looked like at the beginning of this project, our offsite backup server is ready to go, meaning we have a 3-2-1 backup solution in place for the first time in years, practicing what we preach. Just like I practice these segues. KiwiCo is our sponsor for today's video, and they're a monthly subscription service to help make STEM topics fun and interactive for kids of all ages. They believe that if you learn small things today, they can turn into world-changing ideas tomorrow. So each month, you'll get a themed crate to learn specific topics. Each crate is designed by experts and contains everything you need to complete it, which means you don't need to run off to the store to get extra supplies like glue or scissors or whatever. The crate that we're showing here is at a Kiwi level that's for kids ages 5 to 8 that'll teach programming and robotics. Another one is the Eureka level for your teens ages 14 plus that highlight basic engineering and sound practices. KiwiCo is a great way to keep your kids occupied for hours, and you can check it out today at kiwico.com/LTT, where you'll also get 50% off your first month of any crate. If you guys enjoyed this video, you might also enjoy, oh, maybe a lower capacity but higher performance one. New Whonnock server.
Whonnock 3.
Man, the rollout for it freaking couldn't have gone any better, actually, and that thing is flipping fast. We're gonna have a playlist where you can watch all the new Whonnock stuff. Can you make a playlist?
I can make the playlist, but it's gonna be called the Whonnock 3
playlist. Link it below, new Whonnock.